Hello, so welcome to the next one. Right now, we are going to talk about D'Alembert's principle. So, this one is checking whether the video is correct, right, or you can see this person or not. See, right now I'm talking about D'Alembert's principle. Okay, so what is that? D'Alembert's principle, with that concept, we can solve a lot of questions. So this is very easy to understand, and this is also very important to understand. So that is why. Please check this very carefully. Suppose what we have learned from our Newton's law. If there is a body and there are some forces acting in this body, like this, and one force is like this frictional resistance. So summation of all the forces from all the forces, whatever we are getting, if I do the summation of all the forces, that will cause some mass and into acceleration. That will cause some acceleration of this mass. That is, if this body will start to move, when it will start to move, when there will some acceleration, because right now acceleration is zero, and because of the application of the forces F1, F2, F. This F1 is acting like this, a component of this will be acting in this way. F2 is acting like this, F1 is acting like this. Suppose the summation of this is greater than F, then there will be a net force acting in this direction in the body. So because of that force, this body will start to move in this direction. So that we know that is equal to mass into acceleration of the body. Okay. In here, up to this much, in Newton's law, we have seen this. Okay. Net force acting on the body is equal to mass into acceleration. But what D'Alembert said, that there is a body, it is more or less same, just like Newton's law. Force is acting like this, F2, F1. And F. Okay. So net force is F net is equal to F1 plus F2 F1 suppose this is theta, F1 cos theta plus F2 minus F, that is mu times Rn, frictional resistance. Okay. That if I do this, then there will be some mass into acceleration. Now if I put an imaginary force in this direction, that is some m into a, and because of this the body was having some mass into acceleration in this direction, I'm putting an imaginary force in this direction, and because of these two forces, the body will be in dynamic equilibrium. Okay. Listen to this again. Just try to understand. This is some imaginary force we are putting, and this is called inertial force. D'Alembert said that this is inertial force. Okay. So in this direction, inertial force is acting. And because of that, this is causing some mass into acceleration. I am putting same imaginary mass into acceleration in this direction, and that is what I am calling inertial force. Okay. Because of these two, the net force will be zero. So what I can write, this one I am writing Fi, inertial force. So F net minus Fi is equal to zero. Okay. F net minus Fi equal to zero. If you do that, it is just same like Newton's law. But what we have got, the concept of inertial force, that one thing, and the dynamic equilibrium. It means this body will be definitely moving, but because of the inertial force, we can write that F net minus F I is equal to zero. Zero means some kind of equilibrium, but this body is moving, so we can say this is in dynamic equilibrium. So that is how D'Alembert's principle differs from Newton's third law. With another example, we can see what it states. So, first of all, this is a pulley like this. Okay. I am taking a string like this. Suppose this is M1, this mass is M1, and this mass is M2. This mass is M2. Okay. What will be there if this is M1? Suppose M1 is greater than M2. If this happens, then the M1, the body, will move in this direction. M2 will be going up. Clear? M2 will be going up. M1 is like this. Suppose there is no friction between this. Imagine that this is having zero friction, so no frictional resistance is there. Now, because of this, if M1 is greater than M2, then this will go down, this will move up. How it is moving up? See, what is the net force? I am taking this one. This is, suppose, 1, 1, section 1, 1. This is, suppose, section 2, 2. So, because of this, if I take section 1, 1, then I can see, it is like this. M1 in here. So, drawing bigger here. M1 acting like this in a downward direction, and then M2 will be acting like this. Where T will be acting like this in the direction. So what is the, because of this mass, what will be the force? Because of this mass there will be some M1 times G, mass into acceleration due to gravitation is there, and here T is there. So because that mg and t is because of which? T is because of this one. Okay. So m1 is acting downward, m1 into g, and t is acting upward. So force is acting downward and this force is acting upward. But due to these two forces, the body is moving downward. That means m1 into g is greater than t. That is for sure. If it is moving downward, if it is going downward, then M1 into G is greater than T, is more than T. So I can write that M1 into G minus T, this is downward, this is upward, is causing some mass of 1 into acceleration. Okay. How? From Newton's second law of motion. Newton's second law. Look at the section 2-2. If I take section 2-2, then it is something like T will be upward and M2 into G is downward. Okay. M2 into G is downward, T is upward. In this case, this body is moving upward, that means M2 into G is less than the T. So in this case, T is greater than M2 into G. And in this case, I can write that M1 into G is greater than T. Here, T is greater than M2 into G. And because of that, it is causing same acceleration in the body. Whatever acceleration we have got in case of mass A, mass 1, we are getting the same acceleration, because this will move at a, with a velocity, this will move with the same velocity, then only we can say that it is moving like this, then only it is possible. So T is acting upward, M2 into G is acting downward, so that means T is greater than M2 into G, so T minus M2 into G is equal to M2 into A. The net force is T minus M2 into G, and that is causing a mass into acceleration in the body. That is also Newton's second law. Now, how D'Alembert differs from this? In case of D'Alembert, take one section, this section, D'Alembert. In this case, you take one. In here, T is acting upward, M1 into G is acting downward. Okay. Now I am not going to write that T minus M1 minus G in M1 into G minus T is equal to like this. I am just going to take a pseudo force and inertial force also in here, which because of which this body will be in dynamic equilibrium. So this one I am taking as M1 into G, M1 into A. So now I can write that T plus M1 into A is equal to M1 into G. This is the only difference between D'Alembert's law and this. I am taking this inertial force. Okay, it was there, it was causing some mass into acceleration, but I am telling that this is in dynamic equilibrium. Now I can write T and M1 into G will be, because of these two force and this one force, it will be in a dynamic equilibrium. One thing, if you look at section 2.2, what is the difference? I can write that this 2.2, T is more than M2 into G. M2 into G is in here. Okay. So T is more than M2 into G. Put an inertial force in here. M2 into A. Now I can write T is equal to M2 into A plus M2 into G. This is the only difference. I am taking this inertial force in here. That is the only difference. So what you have learned from D'Alembert's law, that net force acting on a body is actually the inertial force. Net force is M1 into G minus T. That is, net force is actually the inertial force. Or you can say that this one, your M1 into G minus T, that is the net force, is actually the inertial force. Or we can say that because of these two, inertial force and this one, the body will be in dynamic equilibrium. It means M1 into G minus T minus M1 into A is equal to 0. That is dynamic equilibrium. Now let us solve one question with help of this law and we will see how. So this concept is clear, I hope. After that we are moving to the question. This question says that a motorist is traveling at a speed of 70 km per hour. Suddenly he applies brake and halts after 50 meter distance. Determine the time required to stop the bike and find the coefficient of friction between the road and the tire of the motorcycle. So, question example. Motorist moving with 70 km per hour, 70 km per hour. What is 70 km per hour? I have got this as 19.44 meter per second. I've got this as 19.42 meter. Now, he suddenly applies brakes and halts after 50 meter distance. So, S is equal to 50 meter. The distance is 50 meter. Determine the time required to stop the bike. T is equal to how much? Okay. So, what is this? This is the initial velocity. It was, the bike was moving at a speed of 19.44 meter per second. That was the initial velocity. And final velocity is, the bike stops. That is, final velocity is zero. So, initial velocity is U is equal to 19.44 and V is equal to zero. Now, I can calculate this one. G square is equal to U square plus 2AS. So, I can write this as V is equal to this, your V square is equal to 0, that is 19.44 whole square plus 2AS is 50. There only unknown is A, but A I have got as A is, I have got this value as minus 3.77 meter per second square. What it is saying, that it is not actually acceleration, it is actually deacceleration. It is, bike is stopping, so it is actually deacceleration. Now I can find the other answer, that is V is equal to U plus AT. I need the time, okay, after how many seconds or how many minutes it will stop, the bike will stop. So the V is equal to U plus AT. I have got A value as this. T is unknown, V is 0, U is this one. So V is equal to 0, 19.44 plus minus 3.77 into T. So I have got this as T is equal to 5.14 second. So after 5.14 second, the bike will come to S. Static portion, that is bike will stop. After that he has asked, what is the coefficient of friction acting between the tire and the road? So for that, now we can do D'Alembert's principle. See, coefficient of friction, if I draw the free body diagram of this, suppose this is a block, suppose this is a bike or any mass, its weight is acting like this, that is mass into acceleration, normal component is acting like this, okay. So weight is acting like this and normal component acting like this, this mass into acceleration is actually weight, is how much this one is, if this one is mg, then this one is actually mu times mg or mu times rn. What is rn? Rn is w. Rn is w or mg. This is normal reaction. This is rn. So normal reaction I am writing as rn, or here also you can write it as rn. So mu times rn is this one. Now what is the force, net force acting? Say in this direction there is no net force, in this direction this is mu times rn. So I am writing positive x as 0, negative x as mu times rn. And that should be equal to the mass into acceleration. That is, mass into acceleration is how much? Your m into a. Mass of the body into acceleration. Acceleration we have already found as this one. So mu is minus mu times rn is how much? Rn is w, rn is actually w, that is equal to m times minus 3.77 meter per second square. This is, now what is this w? W is equal to m into g, minus mu times m into g is actually equal to m into minus 3.77 meter per second square. So this and this one, mu is how much? Minus this one, negative is gone, mu is actually 3.77 divided by 9.81. So that is how much? That is equal to 0.385. So coefficient of friction between the rod and the tire is 0.385. So how we are applying the B-Lambert's principle to get this answer? Net force, wherever we will see that there is some net force that will cause some mass into acceleration. As we are having the acceleration of the body, I can guess that from here we can get the answer. So body is moving like this, our frictional resistance is acting like this. Because of frictional resistance only it will stop. Now I can write mu times Rn, that is frictional resistance. In this direction this is zero. So I have got that from D'Alembert's principle this answer will come. So that is why I have written D'Alembert's principle, and then this one is the inertial force. So this is mass into acceleration, and this is how I have got the answer. So this is one of the examples where we can use the D'Alembert's principle or application of D'Alembert's principle. So in the next lecture we'll see some new topic. Thank you.